leader and for the people of Israel who were ready to go into Canaan. They're going to go and encounter a new way of life. They were going to go and encounter something that they never knew before, being prosperous. They just left Egypt after 400 years of slavery. That's the verse number one. Proverbs 28:13. Proverbs 28:13. And this version says the following: He who conceals his transgressions will not prosper. Another version said, he who hides his sin will not prosper. But he who confesses and forsakes them will find compassion. Now, as a way of introduction, I have learned to see situations in church and outside of the church as to what they are without trying to put a cap of excuse. I have learned to see my life the same way because my background demands that for me. I cannot play games with my life or the way that I used to behave. And when I reached for help, this person told me, if I ever catch you in a lie, if I ever catch you in something, if you ever say something to me and you don't do it, that's the end of this. I'll go with you to the end if you are one thing that you never knew how to be. And I say, what is that? He says, honest. Not honest with me, honest with yourself. He says, I want to teach you something that you never had done. Now, with all the respect of everybody here tonight, most people that I know have that problem, in and outside the church. I don't say that I'm exempt. Let's be clear about that. But when you come to minister, you see the result of the problem. And you see, it is not prosperity, it is not something that is growing or advancing to the with the purpose of God. There is something in there that hasn't been confessed. There is something in there, it's a root of sin, deep in that situation, in such a way that doesn't allow the prosperity of God in the organization or in the person. We have a tremendous principle in the Word of God that we have to learn properly and responsibly. Amen. And that is that we are one body. We don't belong to ourselves as we used to. We belong to Christ, and He has introduced us to His church that is His body and His name. So everything that you do, as everything that I do, affects you and affects me. Whether I know it or not, that's the way it is. Now, the other principle that I wanted to talk about tonight is the principle of typology in the Bible. I talk a lot about that. I don't probably have to bore about that. Sorry about that. In the book of the Gospel of Luke, in chapter 5, verse 12 to 16, we find
the encounter of this man that is a leper with Jesus. Now, in the Bible, leprosy is type of sin. Leprosy equals sin. It is an incurable disease to this day. There is two types of leprosy. One that affects the mind immediately in your sight. And the person who gets that kind of leprosy won't last more than 5 years. The other leprosy that exists is the one that attacks the body more than the mind, and it starts affecting all your nerve system, and you start decaying in your body, and sooner or later you start losing the members of your body. They will fall off. The other thing that does leprosy is that you lose the sensitivity, you don't feel pain. You lose that sense of pain. Sin does the same thing to the soul of the human being. When you are a sinner, you have a problem that doesn't get cured by human religion. Now listen to me, please. There is a big difference between being a religious person and become a spiritual being. I was listening very attentively to the missionary lady of Japan. And this just happened. I don't know if you saw a program about Japan this week in the television. And they were describing the people of Japan in that program. They are the most prosperous nation in the world right now. It's not China or the United States, it's Japan. They are the most healthy people in the world. They have the best diets in Japan. They have a growth of population very under control in such a way that according to the economy grows, it grows the population. However, Japan has the highest percentage of people committing suicide. So as you can tell, it's very easy to realize and to think, how come if they are so prosperous, how come if they are so healthy, how come they kill themselves so much? I wouldn't be surprised if somebody here tonight they had thought of killing himself or herself. Because I have. It was a moment in my life that I said, what's the use? And if it wasn't because of divine intervention, I probably wouldn't be here tonight. Now let me quote the other portion of the Bible. Psalm 51. I'm going to go directly to verse 7. Purify me with hyssop, I mean, that's pronounced, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than the snow. There is this man that wrote this psalm, King David. King David, at this moment in his life, was at the top of being prosperous. He had conquered all his enemies, but he hasn't conquered his heart. And not too long before he wrote that psalm, he had committed adultery with Bathsheba. And not too long before he wrote that psalm, He committed murder to her wife, her husband. This man, please pay attention, the Bible describes as a man with a heart for God. He's crying to the Lord to wash his heart because he's in a lot of trouble. And he says to him, please wash my heart because so I can be white as snow. I'm quite sure that probably most of you have been in places with snow. There is a snow when it starts coming down. I don't know if you've been in a place like that. I have. And it's really white. But if you are in a city like New York or anywhere else in this, or even here, and right after the snow, hot snow, and then the traffic of the city start going over that snow, it is not as white as it came. It's really ugly, really. It's filthy. This man has made mistakes. This is the biggest of the censure that he commented in his argument. The fact that he thought that he could build a temple for God, and now with this new relationship that he got into, this man that the Bible proclaims that he's a man with the heart of God shows me how delicate the heart of our heart is. How blind can you be? Please don't make an exception to think that you are not going to go into that problem like David. He had the power on his hand of life and death to his enemies. He had the power in his life to do just about everything in his life. He was the king. He was a man that the Lord had reminded not to look at after in 1 Samuel. That he was just a simple pastor. And now God had put him as a king of that place. Okay, that's the introduction. Let's not be so serious. Let's go to Luke 5. Verse 12. And it came about it that while he was in one of the cities, behold, there was a man full of leprosy. And when he saw Jesus, he fell on his face and implored him, saying, Lord, you are willing, you can make me clean. Verse 13. And he stretched out his hand and touched him, saying, I am willing. And immediately the leprosy left him. Verse 14. And he ordered him to tell no one, but go and show yourself to the priest and make an offering for your cleansing, just as Moses commanded for a testimony to them. I remember how filthy I felt when I came to the Lord. We are talking about leprosy. It was a law that you find in the Leviticus that a man with leprosy had to go around the city or wherever he was. He was not allowed to go into any crowd because that would be breaking the law. He had to use a special way of dressing, and his dress had to be really old Torah. He had to have a stick with a belt. And he had to go around the city or wherever he was walking, saying,
unclean, unclean, unclean. So people knew that he was sick and that this disease that he had was contagious. And everybody would have to run away. As you meditate in this passage, he broke the law. He came into the crowd where Jesus was. Right there, he was breaking the law. Right there, he was putting himself in a predicament that he could be stoned right there and get killed. But he was so desperate because it had been many years of having that sickness, and he had lost everything, and he was condemned because the law in Leviticus declares that you cannot have family, you cannot have friends, you cannot associate with anybody. That's the law of the lepers. That's the law of sin. When you are a sinner, you contaminate everything and everybody around you. And don't you kill yourself. That's the way it is. It's not a little thing. It is a big thing in the life of a church and a life of the Christian. I just read to you Proverbs 27:13. If we don't confess our sin, we'll never prosper. We will never have prosperity. When a church is not prospering, there is sin in the church. And that's the way it is. You can go around and around and around finding all kinds of excuses. But the way it is what the Word of God says. It has nothing to do with anything other than sin. This man comes, break the law, and presented himself to Jesus. I'm going to repeat that again because it sounds so simple. He didn't go to a doctor, he didn't go to a hospital, he heard that Jesus was making miracles. And he went and made room in the crowd, and he fell in front of Jesus. He says, "Lord, have mercy on me." I don't know about you, but really, you know, I tried to picture this man tired, filthy. He smelled bad because leprosy smelled really bad. And he begged God to Jesus to please do something for him. Now, if it's not a picture like the beautiful picture that this missionary lady presented us today, it really touched my heart this morning. And I see the Lord trying to help Peter in the waters. That's a beautiful picture. I would like to see a picture of this man in front of God asking him, "If you are willing, Lord, if you are willing." And the Lord in his love, because he is God, and he cannot deny himself. And you and I have to realize that, not here, that the one that we are calling cannot deny himself, but we have to call. We have to call and say, "Help. I cannot do it by myself. I don't care how many years I have been in the Lord. I always will need God for everything." One of the problems that we might have in church is that we think that we can manage this thing. We cannot.
we always will need Him. And every time that we get in trouble, we have to run to Him and ask us to cleanse us and to help us and to give us power and the desire to be white as snow. You think that there are people that wanted to do that? Yes, there are people that don't want to be cleansed. And I can give it to you an example through the Bible. For in the Last Supper, the Lord saw His 12 disciples that nobody cared for them, that they had their teeth filthy. And He gave water and then soap and then started washing their feet because it represented the same thing. And then Peter says, "You won't wash me." And then the Lord answered, if you don't allow me to wash you, you have no part of me. This is in conjunction in relation to what Paul is asking us. In chapter 12 of the book of Romans, we have to learn to present our bodies to God. Not only once. We constantly have to go to God and present our bodies and say, "God, have mercy on me. Maybe it's just me that I've been having so much trouble lately in Carlos. Never mind anybody else. But the old Carlos have a tendency to visit me to see how am I doing, I guess. I don't know. We have to learn to, I have to learn, to see what is the result of the sin. I don't know if you ever read this passage several times. I don't say that to make you feel guilty or anything like that. If you feel guilty, that's good. Sin is something that you cannot ignore. The result of sin is you get incapacitated. You see, when you are a leper, you cannot work, you lose all your strength, nobody wants to do anything to do with you, etc. When you are a sinner, you begin to see that personality in the person. Always have the tendency to be alone. Always have the tendency to just don't be bothered with anything or anybody. There is something hiding in that heart that doesn't allow, because it doesn't have the capacity to produce love. Sin does that. Sin produces loneliness. Even if you're married with 12 kids in your house, sin will destroy the relationship between you, your wife, your son, your daughter, and everybody at work. It's not that we have the tendency in the church to say, "You're a sinner," and that we end up with that noise. All the consequences that come with that. Totally dysfunctional, you become. So we understand it's like having a diesel car, vehicle, or vice versa, a gasoline car, and put diesel in the gasoline car or put gasoline in the diesel car. You won't be able to function. You won't be able to run. You will destroy the motor. Human dynamic cannot destroy the effects of sin. With all due respect to everybody that is here and is not here, pride is the thing that really kills churches. The sin of pride. You don't allow anybody to tell you that you are wrong.
see when you and I study the Bible, God started giving you a picture of you. I don't know about you, but that's what happened to me. It's very common that when you are ministering, people say to you, Yeah, I know, but. And but I know that what is going to say after that is the excuse for the sin. I'm going to take you back to Joshua. Be brave. Be brave is the commandment in chapter 1 of the book of Joshua. You have to be brave to enter and conquer that place. You have to be brave to enter and conquer your heart. For God is going to show you things that are in your heart that are not very blessed. I'm so accustomed to do those things that they don't bother me no more. You have become insensitive, just like the lepers. Now, sin progress has a gross progressively worse ending in a spiritual death. I probably have made all the mistakes that a person can make in my life. And I have made a lot of mistakes in ministry. The one thing that I won't do and I refuse to do unless the Lord come and tell me is that if you ask me, I'm going to tell you exactly what I think that the problem is. I won't go around the bush. I will tell you, you are in sin. And that's the problem right there. And unless you renounce to that, to confess that sin, and to start all over again, this problem will continue and it get worse. It never gets any better. Revelation 20, 14 and 15 talks about that. As a matter of fact, she was talking about that this morning. You got called victim of the second death. Let me please bear with me. Verse 14. And the dead in the Hades withdrawn into the lake of fire. This is the second death, the lake of fire. And if anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. I'm not going to go into a theological discussion because I don't think that I'm qualified for that in the first place. It's just my opinion. Not for what the First Point Church says, but for what I have read in the Bible, in the way that I understand the Bible, maybe something I understand better or different. But I believe that you can lose your salvation. That's my opinion. I believe that I cannot play games with this thing called the relationship with God. To our Lord Jesus Christ. I don't know if you got the same message in the way that you understood the message of this morning from this lady. It was a sad message to hear these Japanese beautiful people that they don't believe in salvation because of the Buddha way of analyzing things. And I have seen things, because I was a missionary myself in Latin America, how religious way of thinking destroyed the relationship between God and people. Take religious religiosity doesn't allow anything new to come to you. Religiosity stops the voice of the Holy Spirit.
encounters that we have in Latin churches, Latin American churches, is the background from the people come from. I'm not talking about finances, I'm talking about the way the traditions are. How do I start to ask God to help me? I don't know if I'm the only person that goes through this. Let me give you an example. Somebody do something to me, okay? It's an example. And your heart gets what we call a resentment in the human language. I call it different. I call it your heart develops hate against the other person. And instead of going to confront that person in the Christian way, you allow that resentment and you feed fire to that resentment. And you continue adding things and thoughts and things to that, trying to justify that the resentment that you have is approved by God. I'm going to go down to say, as I understand the Bible, because I don't know how much you suffered prior to coming to the Lord, I don't want to go back there. And I've been very close to go back there. And you see, I didn't understand this thing, the Word of God. Not just the Bible, the Word of God. And when I started this way, called the new way, Christ is the way, and I started studying how this man, that they say that is the Savior of the universe, talk, and I start reading chapter 5 of the book of Matthew, and I start seeing what this man is saying. You have heard that I tell you. You have heard that I tell you. You have heard that I tell you. Taking that passage in context, in the real way that you're supposed to take that passage, and you see who he is talking to. He's talking to the Hebrew people, to the people who are supposed to know the law. He's not talking to the Gentiles like me. He's talking to his people. People who are supposed to know the law of God. And by those phrases you have heard that I tell you, Jesus starts telling them how wrong they are. How misinterpreting the Bible can kill you. How can you justify yourself by your